special thank you again to Smith and Nephew and Dr. Philippon for inviting me to be part of this course. I think also a special thank you to Dr. Philippon is important because I think it's his vision and technical skill that allowed Reconstruction to be part of our armamentarium for the hip. My disclosure is really no effect or bearing on this talk. A lot of people ask me in the lab or just in general, you know, how do you decide what you do? And so I thought it'd be good just to kind of make a little slide to help you see that. For me, if the tissue's healthy, my goal is to repair the tissue. If we can get our own tissue to heal, it already has a vascular supply, it probably will do better. So that's the thought process there. And we typically see this in our younger patients. If, however, we get into the joint and the labrum severely degenerative, hypertrophic, red, nasty, that's a labrum that if I repair may do well for a while, but in my experience, kind of falls apart 6 months to 2 years out. And I don't really like that. So what I've done now is I do a primary labral reconstruction in those situations. Or if we're in a revision situation, if I tried to repair a labrum before, I tried to re-repair, I think, 10. 8 of the 10 failed, and I went on to a reconstruction in them. So I don't think labral re-repairs really work well for me. So that's a reconstruction. If I get in there and the labrum is torn, cartilage is a little bit more degenerative than I expected, particularly the central aspect of the femoral head. That's usually a bad sign. Or if the patient physiologically is older than 60, I don't think they have the ability to fully heal a labral repair or incorporate a reconstruction. Those I do a complete labral resection. So I remove virtually all the labral tissue. And I think when you look at Dr. Bird's data, he's got the longest outcomes of any of us. And he gets good results with this. So I think it's a procedure that should be something that we think about. Everybody gets treatment of their FAI. And sometimes we'll do an associated procedure like a microfracture or psoas release. This is an example of an Olympic pentathlete. She's got a pretty healthy labral tissue, but a pretty good tear through here. This is somebody that gets a repair. This comes out nicely, should heal pretty well, and should work pretty well for this patient. This joint is one that you get into, and you're like, geez, that MRI didn't look this bad. How did I get into this situation? And you get in here, you see massive synovitis. But the cool thing that you see for this patient is you say, well, maybe my indications were okay here because my cartilage looks okay on the ball and okay on the cup. I clean out all this synovitic reaction, I get rid of the labrum, I burr the acetabular rim pretty aggressively, and then we put in a labral reconstruction. This joint doesn't look too bad. And we give them a fighting shot, and I think this is their best opportunity to move forward, because if you try and repair this garbage tissue, I don't think you're going to fully remove their pain. Labral reconstruction, for me, just a note, so you know, Chris is my assistant. He does a very nice job forming a very nice cylindrical graft that's nice and firm. The way to do that is multiple sutures, as you see, kind of running in baseball fashion. So these aren't our fixation points. Our fixation points are here, here, and here. For me, I think a labral reconstruction is probably a little bit better than a debridement in a very young, active patient. The best thing about this, and this is where this procedure has so much value, is that it can never become painful. It's aneural. So you've removed the pain generator within the joint, which is most likely the labrum, and you've put in a graft that you can't feel. And then the best part about it is if the technique grows and you get to the point where you can do it anatomically, you can reproduce their normal anatomy, and potentially it can be curative. The other benefit that we talk about, and I need some smart people who have access to a biomechanical lab to figure this out for me, but I really think that the main function of the labrum, yes, seal, all these other things, very, very important. But I think the big thing is that cartilage in the body doesn't like shear. It loves compression. That's why we have these cartilage injuries long term after an ACL injury. And I think what happens is when the ball rotates into the cup, particularly in these women who have wave signs or intersubstance delamination of lateral cartilage, I think this cartilage sees a lot of shear force. And I think a huge benefit of a labral graft or a labrum itself is to create a seal and prevent that lateral acetabular cartilage, or at least diminish some of that shearing force that that lateral cartilage would see. The other major benefit of this is sometimes if you're going to do a takedown of your labrum and an aggressive rim trimming, you're a little bit limited in the geography in which you can do your rim trimming. Huge benefit of getting rid of the labrum is now you can be very aggressive. You can see this is somebody, I think her pincer was, or I should say center edge, was in the 38 to 40 range. So we had a lot of redundant cup. Because of that, we remove the labrum, remove the edge of the cup. Well, now we get back to a pretty healthy joint through here. And we've functionally removed all of our arthritic degeneration. My personal evolution, this is everything from Dr. Philippon. I remember I tried to send my first patient to him, and it just couldn't work out. And so I said to her, well, I'll give you everything I have, and we'll do it the best way we can. And I was using autograft at that time. For me, it's about a 27-patient cohort. My grafts initially were about 4 to 5 centimeters, and that was about the workable length within the acetabulum that I could work on safely, get anchors in, and do it properly. I did it only for revision cases, and I think that's a great place to start if you start learning this procedure, because it's probably the only thing that's going to work if you're going to do another hip scope. I did one case in December of 2010. It was a big-time skier, terrible deformity. We worked on him forever, and we got the graft out. It was autografted. And the one problem I had with iliotibial band autograft is sometimes I would take a rectangle out, and I think it looked perfect, and then we get it on the back table, and it'd be a little thin in one segment, a little thicker in one segment. And when we tubularized this graft, it was a cone instead of a cylinder. And I knew there was no way we were going to get a good seal with this. So what we did was we took an Achilles allograft tail and wrapped it around it, kind of like a pig in a blanket. And we had a cylinder, we put it in, and it looked great. And the guy did awesome. So I scratched my head a little bit, and we talked to our representative down in Denver, and we started working with freeze-dried grafts. And I was happy with this because through this process, my graft length started to increase. I just felt there was a larger zone of injury, and I needed a bigger graft. And eventually, my need for graft exceeded the body's ability to give me an adequate graft. Eventually moved to frozen, and this is May of 2012. Now what you can see is we've had a pretty big jump, and that's just because my confidence with this procedure in the primary setting has grown tremendously. Our graft length now is significantly longer. It's about 8 to 11 centimeters, so a pretty large zone of reconstruction. And I think the technique, you know, I'd drive home at night, and I'd say, geez, what could we do better? And so we were making changes pretty frequently to kind of get more and more anatomic and more anatomically and rigidly fixed. And now I'm happier with the procedure. When you look at where we started, typically my reconstruction at the beginning, and this is a right hip, were from roughly this zone to this zone. And these worked really well. I mean, those initial patients did well, but I had a couple patients that about 6 months to a year out would start developing some pinching and some pain in the front, and they'd start to have a positive anterior impingement test that they didn't have before. Now, frequently, this remnant labrum here, I'd probably put a suture around or do something to it, or maybe just cauterize it a little bit to try and make it a little bit less painful. But I really think that it was this residual tissue left without its normal hoop fibers that became loose with time and became a problem. So the evolution for me was getting to work down in this uncomfortable zone of the acetabulum to make my graft longer. And then working back here, not too bad, although this zone usually gets a little bit thin. It's not that easy to put an anchor in, but making a larger zone for the reconstruction. Our operative time has decreased, so the entire operation, including impingement work and everything else, is about 3 hours now, but it just has to do with the learning curve and getting to the point where we're nice and efficient. The best part about the graft for me is I did have a few patients who had problems with their donor site with the IT band, and it wasn't a problem I could fix. So I like this now because I use allograft for ACLs. I figured it would be fine to use it for this as well because the graft isn't strained as much as it would be for an ACL reconstruction. So this is just a reconstruction technique here. I think, do we have to start it? This is weird. Okay, perfect. So this is an example of a primary reconstruction. You could see this is a pretty nasty labrum, pretty red. It's got some blisters in it. It isn't massively large. And you can see a little wave sign on the edge of the cartilage. For me now, I could get a better result with a reconstruction. So here you can see we've removed the labrum. We burred the acetabular rim. That's the origin of the anterior transverse acetabular ligament. We've maintained our capsule, which is the key for everything. I put in all my anchors in the beginning. It's more efficient, but also the key for the procedure is getting the anchors in a perfect position, okay? And that's the normal zone of reconstruction. Here's our graft. You can see all the tubularization sutures that we put in. The cool part here is the sutures fixed to the sutures fixed to the graft. So when we pull on our post, we can anchor that right down where we want it. I fix it from front to back just to keep appropriate tension on the graft as I'm moving, just because it's hard to get a perfect measurement of exactly how long a segment you need. I use circumferential sutures as I go along, usually about 5 to 6 knots per repair site or fixation site. And then I simply make the graft long. So I cut off remnant in the back so that I have the perfect length. And this is where really three portals makes it easier. The next step is the back. I don't want a circumferential suture to come loose. So what I do here is I pass the suture through the graft. This is an elite pass from Smith & Nephew. Excellent instrument for piercing the graft. What I do is I come through now. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the suture and I'm going to wrap it around the graft, okay, come underneath it. But I'm going to stay above, okay, or anterior to that other suture. So it's kind of like a Mason Allen suture. So this way now, that graft can't come loose. That end can't pop off. And then when you retrieve your post and pull it down, you'll see it secures it down very nicely. So it just locks it right down exactly to the posterior remnant where you want it, and then you just tie down your sutures. This is our final reconstruction. Cool part here is no cartilage damage. We removed it all with the rim trimming, and now we have a nice anatomic graft in the joint. When we put the ball back in the cup, you can see our femoral osteoplasty, and we have an excellent seal on every aspect of our reconstruction of the femoral head. And so there's our final reconstruction. And it's taken a long time to get to this point where we can make it reproducible and to get to the point where we had the confidence to do it in a primary procedure. Other major benefit when we look at the microfracture procedure from Dr. Stebman, wonderful procedure for the knee. I think it's even better for the hip. The hip or the acetabulum represents a concave surface. It's perfectly suited to receive that clot and to hold onto the clot. The other thing is that the pelvis has the most pluripotential cells in the body, so probably the best opportunity to get good fibrocartilage ingrowth. The problem is the majority of our grade 4 lesions are on the edge. So when you see here, this is the ball into the cup. Here's cartilage, here's our gap. If we do a microfracture procedure in this patient, I believe that what's going to happen is you will get some fibrocartilage ingrowth, but it may not be as thick or robust as it should be through here, because what's going to happen is the blood's simply going to fall out of this location. So what we need now is a seal, okay? This is where the labrum or labral graft can be very helpful, and you can see here, before I let down traction, I visualize excellent bleeding that's pretty robust from this area. Then I put the ball back in the cup. There's not a drop that's seeping out. So this gives us an opportunity to potentially get a very thick fibrocartilage bed for healing. When we look at my database since July of 2009, because I agree with Dr. Bird, I think if you're going to do a procedure in high volume, you have an obligation to yourself and to your patients to objectively check what you do. We have about 9 or 10 patients. When we look at our numbers, these are pretty uniform across the board. 24 important point improvement with regard to our Harris hip score and our lower extremity functional score. Pain score reduced. Patients are overall pretty happy. When we look at that in comparison to our reconstructions, we have about 305 hips that we've done a reconstruction on, about 134 with 6-plus month follow-up. It's not a problem. We have a lot that are due to come in for their 6-month follow-up very soon. Okay, so this is early, but at least in the early phase, when you look at these deltas, we're getting very good results. 22 to 27 point improvement in our Harris hip scores, 25-point improvement with regard to our lower extremity functional score, which is probably a better measure for hip arthroscopy interactive patients than the other. And overall, our patients are pretty happy. There are a couple things that I look at that I've learned from for this. The first is, when you look at our primary reconstructions, these numbers, if you just look at them, are very similar to my labral repairs. The other thing is, when we look at our revisions, okay, 64 hips, these patients come in with more baggage. They've had a previous procedure, their muscles don't work properly, they've got more scar tissue, it's a harder patient to get well, so we don't see the same dramatic improvement initially. But my 1-year data, my 18-month data, they're coming around, it just takes longer for them to get there. The other thing that we see is that when we see the reconstructions with microfracture, this is actually probably our best numbers on the page. Well, that doesn't make sense. We're doing more procedures, we have a big cartilage flap, we have more damage, why is this better? I think it's the procedure, but the second thing I think is that when you do a microfracture procedure on a patient, they take that procedure seriously. They take their time with the rehabilitation. They're on crutches for 6 weeks. They're using a CPM machine for 6 to 8 hours a day for 6 weeks. They're taking it slow. Their therapist is respecting the procedure. I think they get better because they take their time. I think one of the mistakes we make is that an arthroscopic surgery of the hip is a massive procedure hidden by the fact it's arthroscopic. We would never let a rotator cuff repair go out and swing a tennis racket at 6 months. We should have that same deference and respect for the hip joint. So when I look at my data here, and this has objectively allowed me to move forward in the direction that I've moved, my reconstructions are similar to my labral repair, and this is impressive because the reconstruction patients have more intra-articular damage. The joint's more beat up. If we can get them to that same final point, it gives me the confidence to move forward with this procedure. I also truly believe that our first surgery represents the best opportunity to have a perfect result. This is true for total knees, total hips, ACLs, everything. The first time we operate, the best opportunity to make it perfect. And so that's why I've moved forward with more and more reconstructions. This is my prediction. This is a little bit, it's out there. But I think that we're probably fixing some ACLs right now. We're fixing some labrums that are too beat up. They don't have the potential to fully heal. When you look at this patient right here, you can see a massive indentation in the neck. This femoral neck has been ramming into the acetabulum for 30 years. There's no way that labral tissue at this point has the capacity to fully heal, be perfectly healthy, and function for the long term. I think in patients over 40 especially, this may become the standard of care in the next several years. I think the benefit of the reconstruction is that you get all of the pluses of the labral tissue, the seal, everything else, but it can never become painful. And that's the true value in this, because patients come to us for pain. That's what we want to take away. I think the labral tissue is the pain generator, so getting rid of it, I think, is helpful. The rehabilitation for me with the reconstructions, it's made my clinic a lot easier. We're able to see a lot more patients because uniformly we're not having this conversation at 4 months. Why am I not better? Why am I flared all the time? Less and less with the reconstructions. It's a more predictable healing and recovery for me. The pearls and pitfalls. I want to temper the enthusiasm for this procedure a little bit because, honestly, this is the most steep learning curve I've ever encountered in my whole life with anything. I think when you start doing this procedure, it's probably good to start with a simple labral debridement if you've never done it before. Then move into 1 to 2 anchor labral repairs in the very anterior quadrant. Get your bony work done. Dr. Clapper had an excellent talk on Michelangelo. We should strive to have perfect femoral osteoplasties that if you showed that x-ray to your friend, they'd say, I don't know if that guy had surgery or not. That looks perfect. That's what we should go for. Get to the point where everything else is perfect, then move towards the reconstruction. I think it'll be something that we will have as part of an armamentarium as we move forward. For me, the perfect graft size, 5 to 6 millimeters in diameter. Anything smaller, you have trouble getting a seal. Anything larger, it's like a big piece of sausage in there. It doesn't look very good, and I don't know if we get adequate compression with the circumferential sutures, and I think that may impact our ability to fully incorporate the graft. Anchor position is critical. Before you move to this procedure, you have to be able to put anchors around the entire acetabulum, fully around, no problem, okay? Because that can't be your hang-up step when you're doing the procedure. It's also important to remember that wherever you put your anchor, this is going to center the graft. Your graft is very sensitive to eversion, much more sensitive than a labral repair ever will be. The other thing is that I believe that the residual labral tissue has lost its hoop fibers and its stress fibers and its strength, and so it can become a pain generator in the future. That's just something to keep in mind. Start with smaller reconstructions, move to larger reconstructions, move down in that anterior inferior zone as you get more and more comfortable. It is a very difficult place to work, but if you can get down there, I think it is helpful for the long term. Thanks.